Here are some of the strangest mysteries science can't explain. Number 6. Cow table manners. Cows. For those of you out there that don't eat burgers and steaks, thank you. That's more for us beef lovers over here. Most of us probably have never given much thought about the ways cows eat, because really, why would you? Cows typically have a balanced diet consisting of grain and wheat, at least the healthiest and tastiest ones anyway. Cows also eat corn on the mega farms, but that's another story. Here's the weird part about how cows eat. When eating, cows will face either north or south. This odd fact went unnoticed until 2008, when a team of German scientists made the discovery by accident. When you consider humans have been herding cattle for thousands of years, that's actually pretty amazing that no one's ever noticed this. According to a story on NPR, German scientist Heinrich Berta was studying how different mammals, including humans, might use the Earth's magnetic fields to orient themselves. He wondered if maybe humans subconsciously aligned north and south while sleeping. What and how much someone needs to be smoking to think of this is up for debate, but he started using Google Earth to look for human campsites. He happened to notice that cows grazing in fields aligned their bodies facing either north or south whenever they ate. After studying nearly 10,000 cows all over the world, he found that nearly all of them align with the Earth's north and south magnetic fields when they chow down. As a little cherry on top, he also found that deer face north and south during meals as well. Now, why do cows and deers do this? No one really knows. It's unheard of for animals to have an internal compass. Bats can detect magnetic fields, as well as birds. But no one has yet figured out why cows and deer have such a great sense of direction. It's something to think about the next time you're driving by a pasture and see cows. You'll at least know which way directions are north and south. Number 5. The placebo effect. Those of us who grew up in the 90s were first introduced to the placebo effect through Space Jam. Facing off against the Monstars, Michael Jordan and the Toon Stars faced a daunting halftime deficit against their monstrous enemies. In order to raise morale, MJ fakes out his teammates by giving them bottles full of secret stuff. That secret stuff turned out to just be water, but it made the Toon Squad believe in themselves. Armed with their newfound confidence, the Toon Squad were able to come from behind to declare victory. Aside from giving cartoon characters the strength to believe in themselves, placebos are actually very important in medical research. They're often used in drug testing, as the control group, as a way to trick recipients into thinking they're getting treatment, when in fact they aren't. Why this tends to be so effective is a bit of a mystery. There's long been a theory that the brain plays a big role in our physical health. Placebos can trigger some sort of psychological response that helps heal the body. A placebo can take many forms, such as pills made of sugar, shots that don't do anything, fake surgeries, and so on. In some cases, patients even know they're being given a placebo and still feel better anyways. Okay. Honestly, it's pretty weird that fake treatments would have any effect whatsoever, but researchers think it has something to do with the mind-body relationship. Because the mind expects something to happen that somehow could trigger the body's chemistry to respond in some way. On top of not fully understanding why placebos can have an effect, there are also some serious ethical issues at play here. Since it sometimes involves a decent amount of deception by the doctors, some medical experts think it's a bad practice altogether. Who's never ever told a little white lie? Number 4. The Voynich Manuscript. No one knows who wrote it, no one knows why it was written to begin with, and no one can even decipher what's written on it. One of the few things we do know about the Voynich Manuscript, thanks to carbon dating, is that it was probably written sometime in the early 15th century. But that's pretty much all we know about its origins. So what's going on with this mysterious old book? Purchased by book dealer Wilfred Voynich in 1912, The book has been dubbed the Voynich Manuscript, since it has no official title. The book is illustrated with plants, weird-looking diagrams, and naked women, and is written in a language that no one alive can seem to decode. This has obviously gave fuel to all kinds of theories, ranging from forgeries to alien handbooks. I still don't get why people tend to credit aliens with almost everything science can explain. Anyways, generally speaking, the thinking is that the manuscript was meant to be some sort of medieval medical book. But that's still kind of a shot in the dark, since the drawings are so puzzling. Not helping matters is the fact that 32 pages seem to be missing from the book, so it could be missing some really important contextual clues. Most of the characters in the book are like nothing anyone has ever written before. And while a few characters in the book do seem to be from the European alphabet, they don't form any coherent meaning, so it might as well just be gibberish. Any meaning from this book is derived through the series of bizarre drawings, which more or less break the book up into six different sections. The jury's still out on the purpose of the book, as well as the book's author. We do know that it was at least written in the early 15th century, and the drawings seem to be in a European style, so we can safely say it probably wasn't aliens. Some people speculated that Voynich himself forged the whole thing as some sort of a way to make money. As I've already said, radiocarbon dating suggests that the book was written sometime between 1404 and 1438. It would be difficult for Voynich to forge an indecipherable book some 4.5 centuries before he was born. Plus, there's documented ownership of the book dating back to the 1500s, so it appears the book is legit. We just have no idea what it's trying to say. The meaning of life, maybe? Nah. Number 3. Baghdad batteries. Batteries are typically thought of as a relatively new invention. The thing is, though, they're not. Well, maybe not anyway. Consisting of three artifacts, the Baghdad battery, or the Parthian battery as some people call it, has puzzled scholars, scientists, and archaeologists for years. A ceramic pot, a copper cylinder, and a single iron rod. What could it possibly have been used for? The artifacts date back to anywhere between 150 BC and 650 AD. Okay, that's a huge time frame, but whatever. During that time period, they still didn't know how to generate electricity, which is what some people think these artifacts were used for. Exactly as the name Baghdad battery would suggest, many people think it was used as some sort of ancient battery. People in this camp say that by adding vinegar or lemon juice, it would combine with the electrode potentials of the copper and the electrodes from the iron rod to create electric currents, probably for the purpose of layering gold onto silver, a process known as electroplating. Sometime after World War II, a guy named William Gray proved this could theoretically work. Of course, the weird thing is that there's no record of any sort of electroplating during this time. It only stands to reason that if they discovered a life-changing innovation such as electricity, they would have at least mentioned it in writing. Plus, many scientists are skeptical as to whether or not these objects combined could have generated enough voltage to really do anything. Others have championed the idea that it was actually used to store sacred texts. Since it resembles objects used for that exact purpose in nearby regions, many archaeologists think the clay jar was used to protect the scripts from the elements. But, like the battery theory, that too is unproven. The truth is, we just don't know what these things were used for, and we'll probably never know for sure. Number 2. The ANTIKYTHERA mechanism. Is it possible that the technology we have today could have been invented a long time ago, but was just lost in time? Maybe, maybe not. Maybe one day, all the advanced tech that were invented in the last 100 years would just get buried through time as well, and people in the future would be fascinated that we knew how to make a cell phone. Anyways, let's talk about the ANTIKYTHERA mechanism. For all intents and purposes, this thing was an ancient analog computer used to predict astrological positions and eclipses as a way to keep track of time. to date. It's believed to be the oldest analog computer in all of human history. Scientists think it dates back anywhere between 150 and 87 BC. The Antikythera mechanism was rediscovered back in 1901 among the remains and artifacts of the Antikythera shipwreck. Since it was underwater for so long, figuring out exactly when it was made has been difficult. Figuring exactly who built it has been difficult as well. But the thinking is that it was probably made by the ancient Greeks. This thing was more than 1,000 years ahead of its time. After it was lost in the shipwreck, the knowledge of how to make it was lost for more than 1,000 years. It wasn't until the 1300s that anything close to that sort of technological advancement was achieved. While scientists have a pretty good idea of what the Antikythera mechanism was used for, they don't know exactly when it was built or who to credit for thinking of it. Number 1. Atacama Skeleton. In 2003, the remains of a human were found in the Atacama Desert in an abandoned town in Chile by a guy named Oscar Munoz. Big deal, right? Human bodies are found all the time. The catch here is that the skeletal remains in question was just 6 inches long with a cone-shaped skull. So unless you've seen 6-inch cone heads walking around, this is some strange shit. As often is the case, this sparked all kinds of rumors and wild theories. Maybe it was some sort of alien-human hybrid, or maybe it was the remnants of an ancient race of tiny humans. Aliens again. But while science can't fully explain this bizarre find, science can debunk some of the more outlandish claims. DNA testing, for example, determined that the skeleton isn't tens of thousands of years old as originally thought. It's relatively modern and contains high-quality DNA, which means that they were able to pinpoint its origins to the western coast of South America. Unfortunately for the alien lovers out there, it's not from some distant galaxy billions of light-years away. Anyways, these little nuggets of info have given scientists some theories to work with. The leading assumption, according to a microbiologist named Gary Nolan, was that this little guy suffered from an array of genetic disorders and died before birth or during birth. In a similar vein, a paleontologist named William Jungers believes the skeleton could be a mummified stillborn fetus. He theorized that it was a regular person who might have suffered from a disease called oxycephaly, which causes the skull to be shaped like a cone. Pretty much like that movie, Coneheads, which is about aliens who have cone-shaped heads. Don't get any wild ideas here. However, not everyone is totally convinced. Some UFO theorists claim that similar remains have been found before, and that these remains were of an older creature. They believe that it could in fact be a distant humanoid race of extraterrestrial origins. There's also Dr. Stephen Greer, the founder of the Disclosure Project, and the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence, who maintains this thing could be a legit alien. He produced a documentary called Sirius, aimed at exploring this possibility. But he still remains on the fence by saying, quote, "We have to be careful proclaiming it to be one thing or another, as we still don't know." While some people believe this all to be a hoax, science can at least explain that the bizarre skeleton found in the Atacama Desert is that of a once living organism. That's just gonna have to do for now. Here's what's next.
The eel is a deep sea fish that basically no one gets to see except when they're on YouTube or they're out at the sea, where it gets occasionally caught in fishing nets. It also goes by the name Pelican Gulper, and probably the coolest one of them all, the Umbrella Mouth Gulper. The gulper eel typically grows to about 2.5...